Thank you, Jay. Hello, judges. Hello, attendees. My name is Thomas Koch. I'm a professor in the Department of Biomedical Sciences at the Ontario Veterinary College. I'm here to introduce our company, eQcell. So please think of eQcell as your veterinary stem cell store and support system. Like humans, animals suffer from a number of diseases for which we have no or only poor solutions. We are working with stem cells as part of the solution. We are particularly interested in frozen stem cells because they are available on demand. So if you have a racehorse with a tendon injury and you would like to treat it, you can take these cells, thaw them, and immediately use them. Another use of these cells is to sell them to other researchers who has a research question that they would like to investigate, but they do not want to spend the time and effort on isolating and standardizing and characterizing the cells. However, if you use frozen cells, it's from one individual into another individual. In Canada, that use of cells is regulated as a drug like any other drug. eQcell will provide all the regulatory support for you to be in legal compliance. So there is veterinary demand. Veterinarians are calling us asking, can we get access to these cells? We will take this opportunity to work with the veterinarians and conduct practice-based research for product approval. We will continue our patient-derived cell therapies to support the company, but we are really interested in these frozen cells that can be available on demand. We will start clinical trials in the horse this year, dogs and cats next year. We would like to enter the US market quickly. We are meeting with equine practitioners in Kentucky this summer to talk about opportunities. We have had $200,000 in sales to date, which has validated our market fit. We have worked with 10 equine practices across 5 provinces. We will have a similar strategy for dogs and cats. We've just received funding from the Gryphon LAAIRs to follow up on the 80 horses that has been treated to date and conduct market analysis and freedom to operate analysis. We met with Health Canada in April, and the minutes of that meeting has been signed off in May, so we now know the pathway forward to conduct clinical trials from a regulatory perspective. Globally, there's only one product approved in this field, and that is for osteoarthritis in horses in Europe, so there's lots of opportunity for us to innovate alongside other startup companies. We are the only company in Canada providing these culture-expanded cells. We will work with the veterinarians to conduct clinical trials as a trusted collaborator and thereby also create barriers for entry for other companies into these specialty clinics. We operate under a master service agreement with the university, which allows us reduced overhead and, importantly, access to highly skilled people. Canada is a great place to do this kind of R&D because for every dollar you spend, you get 42.5% back from the government as a cash check in the mail. Although this is experimental medicine, we are allowed to charge for the products during the clinical trials. We will continue to apply for grant funding, and we hope within a few years to become a R&D site working with a bigger pharmaceutical company for developing these therapies in Canada for the global market. We have put together a strong team and we are still building it. We have put together a number of advisors and we are still building our advisory panel. We have people with corporate experience, human stem cell biologists, knowledge of regulatory affairs in the human space, and veterinary clinical specialists. So now the next step for us is to apply to Health Canada for the clinical trials in horses, dogs, and cats. And today we are seeking further corporate guidance in our sales and business development pipeline and investors that will help us hire people to execute the plan, build inventory of these frozen cells, and equip the practices for conducting the clinical trials. If you have an interest in this field, I'm chairing a conference in September in Niagara-on-the-Lake where you can learn more about veterinary regenerative medicine. Thank you.
All right, now it's time for some questions from the judges. I'll start off. Why, Thomas, did you start with horses first instead of dogs and cats?
So in the veterinary space, it started with horses in the UK, so racehorses with tendon injuries, and it was a particular tendon that is similar to the Achilles tendon in people. And they found that by treating these horses, they didn't get them back to racing any faster, but the risk of re-injury rate was only half of what it was without the cells. So the cells make the tissue repair more elastic in the tendon, so it's less likely to re-injure. And now horses are still the main field in veterinary medicine, but obviously dogs and cats are a growing field as well.
So I believe you mentioned that you had 200,000 in sales right now.
Yeah.
So what are your financial projections for the next couple of years? And what's the size of the market that you think you're going to be able to capture? Let's just stick with the horses.
So with the clinical trials that we would like to do over the next 4 to 5 years and calculating the number of animals in each group of these studies, and the money we can charge even as part of a clinical trial, I'm predicting $2 million in revenue in the horse area and $1 million in revenue in the cat and dog area. With regards to market size, there are global analysis for Fortune 500 companies, and they say that currently the market is 50 million US. They expect it to grow to 140 million US by 2024. And 56% of that market is in North America at the moment. And of that, horses is the main market. It's probably 60% of the market at the moment, but I expect dogs to overtake that.
You talked a little bit about a European competitor in your presentation. What other competitors do you see entering the market?
So in Canada, I'm not sure a lot of people would enter Canada because it's only 2% of the global veterinary market. In the US, there are a number of startup companies. A lot of them are, like ours, associated with the veterinary colleges. The same in Europe. So we're very much all in the same boat, and it's kind of a question of who gets the most leverage to move the fastest. But I think there's a great opportunity in Canada to conduct R&D, and you can take the data set from here to regulatory agencies in Europe, Australia, and the US for product approval, where the markets are much bigger.
So what do you think your biggest risk factors are to you achieving the growth that you want to achieve over the next couple of years?
That we're not able to get investors on board to do the work, and we'll be overtaken by some of these other startup companies. So I think we have a unique opportunity and a window of opportunity right now to be among the first and push hard and partner with pharmaceutical companies to develop this. Pharmaceutical companies are looking at this area, but they don't see any consolidation yet. So they're looking for to see who would they potentially work with to push this field.
So why are your revenue projections so small given the size of the market and your unique position in the market being early?
Yeah, so because I'm right now only looking at what we can do in Canada for a few select diseases. If we had more money and more people, we could target more diseases, and we could, in an ideal situation, we would have enough of a team that we could go and work with other startup companies and maybe merge together, and then that would position us better.
So these projections are just based on one or two
that is
diseases for a horse,
like
now?
Three studies in the horse, a couple of studies in the dog, and one study in cats in Canada.
I'm not sure if you touched on this earlier. Just can you clarify the financial resources you think you need to raise from investors directly to get this? You talked about the human capital that you think you need, but
yeah. So if I were to get $500,000 today, I would hire two or three people. One of them would be in the lab culturing cells 24/7 to build the inventory. One would be writing the clinical trial applications to Health Canada. And that person and maybe another one will help work with the veterinary practices to be in legal compliance and collect all the data. And then, as I said, every time we spend $1, we get 42.5% back in tax credits. So that $500,000 we can grow through tax incentives. We can also leverage it with other grants, so NSERC and so on. They often look for industry support. So if we have money in the company, we can apply for NSERC and graduate student fellowships and so on. So we can make $500,000 really grow in a number of ways.
And when will you, at what point will you start talking to pharmaceuticals?
Sorry. Let's just answer that question in 10 seconds.
So I'm already talking with people that are very well connected in the pharmaceutical industry and who has worked for veterinary pharmaceutical companies, and they have told me that they definitely see a model forward where we very quickly could become a very attractive partner for them. And then they may even buy us out and then use us as their R&D site.
Great. Let's give it up one more time for Thomas and eQcell.